If it's all right, why don't you remain standing, because I want to lead you in a confession if I can. I want to begin by thanking Apostle Fred Price and Dr. Betty for inviting me. God bless you. I love you. Yeah, I see it as my opportunity to give back to them. And so I praise God for that opportunity. And I'm a little confused. Everybody's bragging about their wives, and then you kind of nix that. But I got my beautiful bride here this evening. Suzanne Marie, and she is my high school sweetheart. And next Friday, we will be married 33 years. And there's a lot of talk about mistresses and such. But I never understood that. I never understood the point of stepping out to eat off the floor when I could eat off a clean plate at home. You know, we're in the internet age, and it didn't seem the thing to do to bring stuff, but I wanted to mention something that's on our website. Several of our books, The Spirit of Excellence, this ministry is about excellence. God's Very Own Child, The Blessings and the Benefits of the Gospel That Belong to You. A book that Sue and I co-wrote on marriage, you, me, and God. A book that every young man in America ought to read, 10 words that can change your life. Just 10 words, and it's faith, but it's more than that. It's also character training. And then a book on money, how to get God's blessing and God's anointing on what you do and what you have. And it's a book called The God Touch. And then I did a men's conference in our church January of 2004 that changed our church. 4 messages that changed our church and allowed me to raise the millions of dollars that I needed to buy the 83 acres and to build the building that we're in. And if you go to overcomingfaith.com, those are just click FICWFM special, and they're all there for $50. And in the internet age, that beats hauling stuff around. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Now, we pioneered our church in 1984. We bought land on the interstate in 1985. We built our building in 87, 88, and I had my back to the wall, because it seems like when you build something, the country goes into some kind of strange thing. And I heard Dr. Frederick K.C. Price for the first time in June of 1988. Got addicted, and at that time, he was broadcasting a 55-part series, The Power of Positive Confession. And so I took his ministry, The Other Side of Signs and Wonders, and I took the 55 messages, and I righted the ship. By the time I got to 92, I actually got a raise that year, and the ship was afloat. But by the leading of the Holy Spirit in 1993, there were 3 occasions of giving. You know, you don't have to understand everything. And this is a huge benefit of being full gospel, being led by the Spirit. I don't understand electricity. I never studied that. But I know how to plug the blow dryer into the wall and hit the switch. You know, when I was a boy in high school, I'd work on my own cars. I open the hood of a car now. Man, I don't know what's going on in there. I don't even want to know. But all I know is that when I hit start engine, those 600 horses come alive. So you don't even need to understand everything. But I was led by the Holy Spirit, Sue and I, to give on three occasions in 1983. And by the fall of 1983, we were millionaires. Now, I have devoted myself. See, I didn't understand it, but I followed the leading of the Holy Spirit. And so I've devoted myself to studying from the Word of God why that worked. Because I am convinced that God is a God of principle. And when you learn the principle, the results can be duplicated over and over and over again. And if I know their hearts are that there be 10,000 churches this big and this economically powerful scattered all across this land. In other words, if I know their hearts, they don't want it for themselves only. They want everybody to come into the blessing. That's what I'm going to talk about tonight, the blessing. And I'm going to do my best to lay it down so you can take the CD, study it, see if I know what I'm talking about or not. Look it up, check it out, see for yourselves. How would you like to humor me and make me feel at home? Well, have you got a Bible? You wouldn't go to dinner without a fork, would you? If you have a Bible, lift it up. Say, this is my Bible. It is the Word of God. And it is the will of God for my life. I am who the Word says I am. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ. I'm where the Word says I am. Seated in Christ Jesus. In the heavenly realms. In the place of authority, dominion, and power. I have what the Word says I have. All the blessings of Abraham are mine. And I can do what the Word says I can do. I can do all things through Christ who gives me the strength. Tonight my mind is alert. My spirit is receptive. As I'm taught the Word of God, my life will be changed for the better. And I'll never be the same again. Amen. You may be seated, and thank you, Dr. Price. That is straight out of Four Things We Must Confess. Two men crashed in their private plane on a South Pacific island, and both survived. One of the men brushed himself off and then proceeded to run all over the island to see if they had any chance of survival. When he returned, he rushed up to the other man and screamed, "This island is uninhabited. There's no food. There's no water. We're going to die." The other man leaned back against the fuselage of the wrecked plane, folded his arms, and responded, "No, we're not. I make over $100,000 a week." The first man grabbed his friend and shook him. "Listen, none of that matters now. We are on an uninhabited island. There's no food, there's no water, don't you get it? We're going to die." The other man, unruffled, again responded, "No problem, I make over $100,000 a week." Mystified, the man was taken aback with such a glib answer and again repeated, "For the last time, I'm telling you, we are doomed. There's no one else on this island, there is no food, there is no water. We are going to die." Still unfazed, the first man looked the other in the eyes and said, "Don't you get it? I make over $100,000 a week, and I tithe 10% to my church. My pastor will find us." This evening, I want to talk to you about money. I want to talk to you about faith, and I want to talk to you about wealth creation in your church. This evening, I want to talk to you about the money secret of the New Testament. There are times when suddenly you realize you're nearer the end than the beginning. At the age of 53, the sun cannot rise nor the sun set without this question coming to my mind: how have I accomplished what I have accomplished? For I am convinced that God is a God of principle. He created the earth and set principles at work in the earth. And those principles don't care if you're white or black, male or female. Gravity does not discriminate. Sowing and reaping does not discriminate. So I've set myself to asking, what principles did I employ to get where I am today? Because I am convinced that once you discover a principle that God Himself has set into motion, anyone can work that same principle and get the same result. And that's why I'm here this evening. Of the many things that I learned from Dr. Fred Price is that as the pastor of a church, as the head of the ministry, it is within my power to create the atmosphere for what I desire. So the title of my message this evening is The Money Secret of the New Testament, but it could just as easily be called Creating the Atmosphere for Wealth and Wealth Creation in Your Church. As I begin, let me give you a synopsis of four key principles in the New Testament that the church has ignored and thereby gotten itself into the ditch with regard to success and prosperity. First, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law. In Galatians 3:13, Paul wrote, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. We have been redeemed from the curse of the law. And what is the curse of the law? Sin, which leads to death, sickness, and poverty. And so if we have been redeemed from the curse, then there ought not be any curse evidenced in our lives. Things are so backwards, people brag about the curse. I'm lost there. Second, Christ redeemed us in order that the blessing of Abraham might be ours. Galatians 3:14. He redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham might come to the Gentiles through Christ Jesus. So the reason we were redeemed, the reason we were saved was so that the blessing given to Abraham might come upon the Gentiles. This is the reason we were saved. Third, if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Galatians 3:29. If you belong to Christ, Paul writes in the New International Version, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. So since we belong to Christ, we are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. So as believers in the New Testament, we have every right to believe God for every New Testament promise, but we also have every right to believe God for every Old Testament promise. Fourth, we have a superior covenant, a superior high priest, and superior promises. Speaking of the Old Testament priesthood in Hebrews 8:6, the writer of Hebrews writes, but the ministry Jesus has received is as superior to theirs as the covenant of which he is mediator is superior to the old one, and it is founded on better promises. So we have been redeemed from the curse of the law. We have been redeemed in order that the blessing given to Abraham might come upon the Gentiles. And since we belong to Christ, we are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Not only that, we are qualified to receive every Old Testament promise, every promise that applies to Abraham's seed, as well as every New Testament promise. So we have a superior covenant, a superior high priest, and we have superior promises. So here's my problem. If Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law, from sin which leads to death, from sickness and from poverty, if the reason we were redeemed, the reason we were saved was so that the blessing given to Abraham might come upon the Gentiles, if since we belong to Christ, we are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise, and if we have a superior covenant with a superior high priest and with superior promises, how can it be that the body of Christ consistently experiences inferior results? And there's only one possible answer to the query, and that is the body of Christ hasn't been working the plan. The body of Christ hasn't been working the covenant. Now, the message this evening is not about tithing, but to get to the verse that Pastor Freeman mentioned, 1 Timothy 5:17, I've got to lay some groundwork. That's where I'm headed, but I've got to lay the groundwork to get there. So this evening, I want to talk to you about money, I want to talk to you about faith, and I want to talk to you about wealth creation within your church. I want to talk to you about the money secret of the New Testament. Number one, Jesus is a high priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. Jesus is not a priest in the lineage of Aaron and Levi. Jesus is a priest forever in the lineage of Melchizedek. I'm telling you, this is fundamental. The priesthood of Aaron and Levi has to do with sinning. The priesthood of Melchizedek has to do with winning. And for 2,000 years, we have had our focus on sinning. Every minute that you spend thinking about some other woman is a minute you're not being creative and thinking about winning. Tell your neighbor, we're going to sharpen up the edge tonight. Luke chapter 3 tells us that Mary, the mother of Jesus, was not born into the tribe of Levi, the priestly tribe. No, she was born into the tribe of Judah, the tribe of royalty. Matthew chapter 1 tells us that Joseph, the stepfather of Jesus, was also not born into the tribe of Levi, the priestly tribe. No, he was born into the tribe of Judah, the tribe of royalty. So think about this. All of our lives, we have been led to believe that Jesus sits there at the right hand of God in the lineage of Aaron and Levi to forgive us of our sins, when in reality, he isn't even qualified to hold that post. Hebrews 7:15. And what we have said is even more clear if another priest like Melchizedek appears, like Melchizedek. Verse 22, because of this oath, Jesus has become the guarantee of a better covenant. Verse 27, unlike the other high priests, he does not need to offer sacrifices day after day, first for his own sins and then for the sins of the people. He sacrificed for their sins once for all when he offered himself. Chapter 8, verse 6, Hebrews 8:6. But the ministry Jesus has received is as superior to theirs as the covenant of which he is mediator is superior to the old one, and it is founded on better promises. Now, before you meet me out back when this is over and lynch me, I'm not in any way diminishing what Jesus did on the cross. I'm not in any way diminishing 1 John 1:8. I'm not in any way diminishing our right as the children of God to confess our sins and to receive forgiveness. What I want to do is lay the groundwork as to his function and his role. Jesus is a high priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. Now we know this from six references in the Word of God. Psalm 110 verse 4, you are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. Hebrews 5:6, you are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 10, and was designated by God to be high priest in the order of Melchizedek. Hebrews 6:20, he has become a high priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. Hebrews 7, verse 11, in the order of Melchizedek, not in the order of Aaron. Verse 17, you are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. So right there we have six references demonstrating that Jesus is our high priest forever in the order of Melchizedek, and yet I'm 53 years old and I've never heard a sermon on the order of Melchizedek. It seems to me that if the Word of God says not once, not twice, not three times, not four times, not five times, but six times, that Jesus is a high priest forever in the order of Melchizedek, well, maybe we ought to apply ourselves and find out what is involved in that priesthood. Jesus is not a high priest in the lineage of Aaron and Levi. Rather, Christ is a high priest in the lineage of Melchizedek. And what was Melchizedek's function in the life of Abraham? You know, to me, if you're going to talk about faith, you got to go to Abraham. If you're going to talk about money, you got to go to Abraham. If you're going to talk about success, you got to go to Abraham. And so this is the beginning. This is the beginning of covenant, success, faith, prosperity. Genesis 14, verse 18. Genesis 14:18. Then Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought up bread and wine. He was priest of God Most High, and he blessed Abram, saying, blessed be Abram by God Most High, creator of heaven and earth, and blessed be God Most High, who delivered your enemies into your hand. Then Abram gave him a tenth of everything. So what is going on here? It is the pronouncement of the blessing. Melchizedek pronounces the blessing over Abraham after Abraham tithes. Melchizedek blessed Abraham by pronouncing the blessing over him. And remember what we just saw in Galatians 3:14. He has redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham might come to the Gentiles through Christ Jesus. He redeemed us in order that we have been saved. We have been redeemed in order that the blessing given to Abraham might come to the Gentiles. So this is the reason we were redeemed. So a priest serving in the lineage of Melchizedek would do what Melchizedek did in Abraham's life. And what was that? Well, the function of the order of Melchizedek, the function of Melchizedek was to pronounce the blessing over Abraham. Melchizedek's function was to remind Abraham that the victory he had won and the plunder he had taken was because of God. And Melchizedek's function was to collect the tithe from Abraham, the man who had the promises, the man who was walking in covenant with God Most High. Now, earlier I posed the question, how could we have a superior covenant with a superior high priest and with superior promises, and yet the body of Christ consistently experience inferior results? And there's only one possible answer, and that is the body of Christ has not been working the plan of God. The body of Christ has not been working the covenant. The George Barna survey indicates that out of all churchgoers in the United States of America, only 3% even claim to tithe, and you know as well as I do, some of them are lying. And for evangelicals, this number is only 8%. And this tells me all I need to know about why God's people are defeated. It's no wonder to me then that Christians are the tail and not the head. It's no wonder why so many Christians are sick, broke, and in debt. You see, everybody wants the blessing, friends, but how many people are willing to go through the covenant to get to the blessing? Full gospel churches all over America are singing the blessings of Abraham are mine, but there's not a church anywhere singing the tithing system of Abraham is mine. But as the wet goes with the water, you can't have the one without the other. They go hand in hand. They are, in effect, two sides of the same coin. Jesus is the high priest of our tithe in the order of Melchizedek. And what is involved in this order? Well, because there's only one historical reference to Melchizedek, it is impossible to mess it up. His function was to pronounce the blessing over Abraham. His function was to remind Abraham. And you know, this is a minister's conference. This goes to the heart of how ministers goof up. We need somebody like Apostle Price reminding us, hey, dude, the reason you're blessed is not because you're so smart. It's God. See, the function of Melchizedek was to pronounce the blessing over Abraham, but then to remind Abraham, the reason you took that plunder is because God was with you on that battlefield. Melchizedek's function was to collect the tithe from Abraham, the man who had the promises, the man who was walking in covenant with God. See, Abraham was called by God. Abraham had a covenant. Abraham had promises, but still Abraham had an elder. And the presence and the reality and the function of Melchizedek doesn't diminish Abraham. See, I can come and I can humble myself and I can pay honor where honor's due. That doesn't diminish me. I go home, I'm still the big dog. Do you understand what I'm saying? If we don't have an elder, we're in trouble. We are trouble looking for a time and place to happen. So in Genesis 14, verse 19, he blessed Abram, saying, blessed be Abram by God Most High, creator of heaven and earth, and blessed be God Most High, who delivered your enemies into your hand. Then Abram gave him a tenth of everything. So in order for the order of Melchizedek to take place, you need two things. Say two things. You need a tithe, and you need a priest. Well, the body of Christ has had the priest, the Lord Jesus Christ, but they haven't been showing up with a tithe. Abraham got blessed when he showed up with a tithe. So in order for this to work, you've got to have a priest and you've got to have a tithe. Now get this, the high priest is connected to God and has the ability to bless your life with the physical manifestations of the promises of God. And the covenant man has the ability to show up with a tithe. So you've got to have both. You've got to have the high priest, and you've got to have the covenant man showing up with a tithe. Here's how it worked for Abraham. Abraham, the covenant man, showed up with a tithe. The priest Melchizedek received the tithe and connected the covenant man, Abraham, to him who had the promises, to him who had the power to make the promises come to pass, and that is God. See, Melchizedek is the connection. Abraham presented his tithe to the priest, Melchizedek, and the priest blessed him who had the promises, that is Abraham. So in order for this thing to work, because we have already seen from six references in the Word of God that Jesus is a high priest forever in the order of Melchizedek, Jesus has got to have some covenant people. And the problem, quite frankly, is that his people have either been disobedient on the tithe or they have been ignorant of the benefits of the tithe. In order for this priesthood in the order of Melchizedek to work, someone has got to show up with a tithe. You see, Jesus is certainly able to do his part, that is to bless your life, but you've got a part to play. Tell your neighbor, you've got a part to play. You've got to show up with a tithe. Say it out loud, I've got a part to play, and I'm going to do my part. Jesus is the high priest of our tithe, and his priesthood is based on the power of an indestructible life. I heard Dr. Price mention, you know, ignoring the media. That's one of my favorite things to do, is to ignore the media. My blessing is not based on what's going on. My blessing is based on the power of an indestructible life. Amen. Hebrews 7, 15 and 16. And what we have said is even more clear if another priest like Melchizedek appears, one who has become a priest not on the basis of a regulation as to his ancestry, but on the basis of the power of an indestructible life. And this is why your tithe is important. When you give your tithe in this New Testament era, you connect to Christ, you connect to the power of his indestructible life. The tithe then is your connection. The tithe is your covenant with God. The tithe is your connection to the power of an indestructible life. We also see from the Word of God that Melchizedek served as a type of Christ. Hebrews 7, verses 3 and 4. Like the Son of God, he remains a priest forever. Just think how great he was. Even the patriarch Abraham gave him a tenth of the plunder. He was a king. He was the king of Jerusalem. He was a priest. He was great. And he was the priest of the tithe. But his greatness didn't diminish Abraham. Abraham could just go on down the road being as great as Abraham wanted to be. But Melchizedek served a purpose for Abraham. Melchizedek was Abraham's connection to this power of the blessing. In this New Testament era, Jesus is the one who collects our tithe, and he's the one who blesses our lives. Hebrews 7. This Melchizedek was king of Salem and priest of God Most High. He met Abram returning from the defeat of the kings and blessed him. And Abram gave him a tenth of everything. First, his name means king of righteousness. Then also king of Salem means king of peace. Without father or mother, without genealogy, without beginning of days or end of life. Like the Son of God, he remains a priest forever. Just think how great he was. Even the patriarch Abraham gave him a tenth of the plunder. Now, the law requires the descendants of Levi who become priests to collect a tenth from the people, that is their brothers, even though their brothers are descended from Abraham. This man, however, did not trace his descent from Levi, yet he collected a tenth from Abraham and blessed him who had the promises. And without doubt, the lesser person is blessed by the greater. That's where we're headed. In the one case, the tenth is collected by men who die. Get this. In the one case, the tenth is collected by men who die, but in the other case, by him who is declared to be living. In the one case, that is the Old Testament case, the tithe is collected by men who die. But in the other case, that is the New Testament case, the tithe is collected by him who is declared to be living. And if you search the entirety of the Word of God, there's only one person that we see that reference, and that is him who is declared to be living, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. So Jesus has been called by God the Father a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. He's been called by God a high priest in the order of Melchizedek. And in this New Testament era, we give our tithes to him. When we give our tithe in this New Testament era, we give our tithe to the high priest of our faith, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. And he operates in a certain anointing. That's where I'm headed tonight, anointing. He operates in a certain anointing, and that anointing is the power of an indestructible life. He has been called by God a high priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. And now Jesus, who is connected with the power, now receives our tithes, then turns around and blesses us just like Melchizedek blessed Abraham, him who had the promises. I am telling you, when you wrap your mind around this, it changes your relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Because my focus then gets off sinning. The priesthood of Aaron and Levi has to do with sinning. And the priesthood of Melchizedek has to do with winning. And I don't know about you, but if you sin, you pay a price. If you win, you reap a nice reward. So I'd rather do more winning and less sinning. Say it out loud. I think I'd rather do more winning and a whole lot less sinning. So we have the promises, the Word of God, but what we need to do is add. That's what I want to talk about. Add to the promises, add to the Word of God, the blessing, the power, the anointing of Christ. Melchizedek blessed him who had the promises. Now, Abraham giving his tithe to Melchizedek didn't make Melchizedek rich. Abraham giving his tithe to Melchizedek made Abraham rich. When Sue and I went off to Bible school, our home pastor told us, he said, keep your eyes open and your mouth shut. And I'm a quiet guy, and that's why it takes time to notice me. But I sat there tonight and I watched Pastor Michael Freeman wrestling with this concept of do something, you know, take some action. And we all do that because we come to meetings like this. We all do. We come to meetings like this, and over 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, you see a guy that comes in and he's maybe, you know, maybe he took Greyhound to get here. He's sitting at the back. But you let 5, 10, 15 years go by, before you know it, man, he's up front and he's got one of the biggest churches in America. And then sitting right next to him is some guy, and 15 years later, he hadn't done anything. I pastor 40 nations, and let me tell you, T.D. Jakes told me, he said, it takes a special person to pastor all those people, the 40 nations. You can't pastor 40 nations and be discriminatory in your thinking. So I believe that when God said he shows no favoritism, I just take him at his word that I can take that to the bank. And what he did for Dr. Fred Price, he'll do for me. But wait a minute, I might have to walk that path. You know, I can't like Shondai, Rondai, tie my bow tie, should have bought a Honda, believe I receive and have it by Tuesday. This thing might take some work. It might take some holy guts to get down the road. Kenneth Hagin used to say that the anointing comes by association and the anointing comes by environment. What your relatives and other faith critics want you to believe is that Melchizedek giving his tithe to Abraham giving his tithe to Melchizedek made Melchizedek rich. That's why they say, well, I wouldn't give my money to no preacher. And when they say that, they mean they wouldn't give any of their $5 to no preacher. Because people who talk like that are always broke. Speaking of Melchizedek and speaking of the Lord Jesus Christ, the writer of Hebrews says in Hebrews 7:7, and without doubt the lesser person is blessed by the greater. See, you might think Melchizedek was blessed because Abraham gave him the tithe, and that's what you hear when you listen to your relatives. Well, I wouldn't give my money to no preacher. And the assumption is that Melchizedek was blessed because Abraham gave him the tithe. Whenever you have a relative say that, you ought to say, what money? Because the same folks who talk like that are the same folks who ain't got no money. They ain't got no money. So of course they wouldn't give a preacher their money because they ain't got no money. Now if you'll get this, I'm being humorous, but if you'll get this, you'll be on your way. Melchizedek was not blessed because Abraham gave him the tithe. Abraham, see that man was a king before, Melchizedek was a king before Abraham showed up. Now, Melchizedek was who he was before Abraham ever showed. He was a king and he was a priest. Abraham didn't make Melchizedek. Melchizedek was not blessed because Abraham gave him the tithe. Abraham was blessed because he gave his tithe to the anointed priest of God Most High. See, the problem is that preachers have trained us to give into need, but there's no power in that. A friend of mine was in our church, I don't know, about 18 months ago, and he was asking me about one of our great fathers who's gone on to be with the Lord. And he said, "You're still supporting the ministry, aren't you?" I said, "No." He said, "Not at all." I said, "Not a dime." And he said, "Why not?" I said, "Show me the anointing." "Well, Pastor, that's selfish." "No, that's intelligent." Amen. I ain't giving my money no losing deal. Preachers have trained us. That's what Christian television is about, most of it. But there's no power in that. The power is giving into anointing. The power is giving into fertile soil. You think Melchizedek was blessed because Abraham gave him the tithe. No, Abraham got blessed when he gave the tithe to the anointed man of God as God's representative. The lesser person, that's us, is blessed by the greater person, that is the high priest of our tithe, the Lord Jesus Christ. And without doubt, the lesser person is blessed by the greater. You know, if you're wanting to learn how to better yourself playing basketball or playing golf or playing tennis, how do you get better at anything? By hanging out with lessers? No, you better yourself in any endeavor of life by hanging out with betters. When we go to the high priest, we're going as the lesser and we're giving upward, and he's going to make us better by what he gives back to us. Without doubt, the lesser person is blessed by the greater. How the body of Christ, you see, has been trained to give into need, to give into lack, to give into what's not working. And so long as the body of Christ persists in this bad habit of giving into lack, need, want, and failure, the body of Christ will remain broke. People always complain when you give into the lives of those who already have enough. But why would I give to someone who already has enough? Why would I give Kenneth Hagin serious money every time I saw him? Why do I give Dr. Fred Price serious money every time I see him? Because I'm trying to get what's on him. Because I'm trying to get what's on him to come on me. We'll get there. Tell your neighbor, we'll get there. Have you ever lent money to a relative? Have you ever helped a relative financially? Let me ask you, did that make them better or worse? Did they run right out and get a job and go to work? Did they get inspired to lift themselves out of their condition? Someone could criticize us and say, "Why are you always giving to those successful ministries? Why don't you help someone who doesn't have a worldwide ministry?" Well, because there's no anointing on them. And if I give into failure, I might get failure as a harvest coming back on my life. And I don't want any failure coming back on my life. If I give into lack, I might get lack coming back as a harvest into my life. And I don't want any lack coming back into my life. So how is giving to a losing deal going to lift me up? How is giving into failure going to lift me up? How is giving into lack going to lift me up? I know people that have left our church because we are so blessed and they want to go help somebody who ain't got nothing. I can't pastor ignorance. So how is giving into lack going to lift me up? How is giving into poverty going to lift me up? How is giving into a curse going to lift me up? So if this is how we connect to Christ, then what does it mean when we don't tithe? Well, it means we're not connected. It means we're not connected to the covenant. It means the superior covenant and the superior high priest and the superior promises, all of that is not working on our behalf. Let me go further and say, if we don't bring the tithe, we are messing up Christ's high priesthood ship. It means we're limiting God if we don't show up with the tithe. It means Jesus cannot do for us all that he wants to do for us because we're not doing our part. There's no doubt in my mind, if you're winning people to the saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, God wants all of your needs to be met. He doesn't want you to worry about money, not one night. He wants you to be blessed in your coming and blessed in your going. There's no doubt about that, because we know that from the Word of God. We know that he does not show favoritism. We know he's no respecter of persons. So how is it we have all this disparity of result? If we don't show up with our tithe, that means we don't connect to our high priest through the tithe, then the high priest can't get the blessing back into our lives. He can't speak that blessing into our lives. Aaron's priesthood had to do with sinning, whereas Melchizedek's priesthood had to do with winning. Number two, the money secret of the New Testament. When Kenneth Copeland first started in the ministry, he had lunch one day with Dr. T.L. Osborne. Dr. T.L. said, "Kenneth, do you want to get rich? Then find some preacher who has been called by God to do more than he has money to do, and then help him." Genesis 12, verse 1. The Lord had said to Abram, "Leave your country, your people, and your father's household, and go to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you," or "I will empower you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing." Verse 3 is the key. "I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you." In February of 1997, I was preaching a camp meeting for an elder, apostle, missionary in Mombasa, Kenya. His name was Bud Sickler. And through his ministry, when he went to be with the Lord, 7,000 churches had been pioneered before he went to be with the Lord. But he had a dream about building a church. It stands there today. It's the largest church building in all of East Africa. But the holdup was the roof. February of 97, I'm over there preaching, and the Lord challenged me. He said, "If you'll do this, if you'll put another man's dream and vision ahead of your own, if you'll do this, if you'll put Pastor Bud Sickler's dream and vision ahead of your own, I'll give you anything you want." The dedication of that church was April of 2000. And when I went and preached the dedication of that church in April 2000, if the Archangel Michael himself had come to me and told me that because I had obeyed God and given that $600,000 and had passed that money test, that 6 years hence, in 2006, same month, April 2006, I'd move my ministry onto a $16.5 million campus and 83 acres, I would not have believed it. The reason it's hard for most people to pass the money test is because they can't see where they could be in 5 years financially if they would just go ahead and obey God and believe God and do what God was asking them to do, taking me back to where I started on following the leading of the Holy Spirit. You can't see the future. And that's why most believers never pass the money test. They're walking by sight, man. They're not walking by faith. They can't see it, so they don't do it. Now, I want to explain to you the money secret of the New Testament and why the body of Christ is poor. Yes, there is a money secret in the New Testament, and I call it a secret not because it's a secret, because so few understand this principle and fewer still practice this principle. It ties back into Abraham and Melchizedek. And when I teach this, it answers the question, why is the body of Christ so broke? The easiest, quickest example is Proverbs 3, 9, and 10. Proverbs 3, 9, and 10. "Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops, then your barns will be filled to overflowing, and your vats will brim over with new wine." Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits. You see, everyone wants the barns that are filled to overflowing and the vats that brim over with new wine, but how many are willing to honor the Lord with their wealth? How many are willing to honor the Lord with their first fruits? Now, the Lord and his covenant have a price. In our culture today, everybody wants something for nothing. My grandmother was one half Cherokee, which makes me a minority. And I can't live a day of my life without all these sayings rumbling around in my head from my Cherokee grandmother. All these sayings like, if it's worth doing, it's worth doing right. Everything has a place, everything in its place, all of these things. And one of them was, if it's free, it ain't worth having. I mean, if I saw a restaurant on the way back to the hotel tonight and it said free food, I would not stop. The Lord and His covenant have a price. And that price is to give the Lord a minimum of 10% of everything that crosses your hands. That is the price. Why in the world? You have Universal Studios here. You got Disneyland. Why would anybody think? Why? What's wrong with people that they think they can go to heaven cheaper than you can go to Disneyland? I mean, what is up with that? So the Lord has a price. And His price is 10%. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. So if you derive something out of this earth, you owe the owner. It's His. It's His. But what about when these modern-day slacker Christians try to walk the Christian lifestyle without paying the Lord's price? It is an honorless, that's the operative word, it is an honorless transaction, and it simply doesn't work. Christianity without the tithe doesn't work. Now the bombshell. Even as the Lord and His covenant have a price, the anointing and the anointed too have a price. I've been preaching 36 years. I've been pastoring a church that I pioneered 25 and a half years. So from my years of experience, I would say the same thing happens when modern-day slacker Christians try to walk the word of faith lifestyle without paying the price, without paying the anointing's price, and without paying the anointed's price. It is an honorless transaction, and it simply doesn't work. Honor is the missing element in the body of Christ today. You know, we get so focused on, you know, fornication and homosexuality and adult. If we just had some honor, we wouldn't be dealing with any of that. But honor has a big part to play in our money. Tell your neighbor, honor has a big part to play in our money. This lack of honor is what causes lack among God's people. And that's why God's people are broke. It's a lack of honor that causes the body of Christ today to suffer from lack financially. It's simply amazing how often wealth and honor go hand in hand in the Bible. Let me run you through these references. Proverbs 8:19. Proverbs 8:19, with me are riches and honor, enduring wealth and prosperity. 1 Kings 3:13. Moreover, I will give you what you have not asked for, both riches and honor, so that in your lifetime you will have no equal among kings. David said to God in 1 Chronicles 29:12, wealth and honor come from you. You are the ruler of all things. In your hands are strength and power to exalt and give strength to all. The Bible says of King David in 1 Chronicles 29:28, he died at a good old age, having enjoyed long life, wealth and honor. His son Solomon succeeded him as king. Proverbs 21:21, he who pursues righteousness and love finds life, prosperity and honor. Proverbs 22:4, humility and the fear of the Lord bring wealth and honor and life. Ecclesiastes 6:2, God gives a man wealth, possessions, and honor so that he lacks nothing his heart desires. And what did God say to King Saul through Samuel in 1 Samuel 2:30? Those who honor me, I will honor, but those who despise me will be disdained. I had a wake-up call years ago. We were still meeting in the hotel when we pioneered the church, and a young man I knew was working at Teen Challenge in Detroit, and I was born in Highland Park, and I was talking to a businessman in the church about Teen Challenge, and I knew this young man that worked in Teen Challenge in Detroit. He said, well, let's go. So we hopped on a jet. We went up there, and we visited. We get to Friday night. Friday night, they had a coffee house down on Jefferson Avenue. I mean, I cannot imagine. I mean, I know you got some dangerous places here, but I mean, I cannot imagine a more dangerous place in America than Jefferson Avenue. And so we're out there. They got a coffee house on Jefferson Avenue. We're out there witnessing. We're witnessing, trying to get, you know, we got prostitutes and, you know, crackheads, all these people, drug dealers, trying to get them into the coffee house. And so, you know, about midnight or whatever, everything wound down. The street people, you know, they all went to whatever they were doing, and the coffee house meeting wound down. It all wound down. And so right across the street was a Frisch's Big Boy. And what are you going to do, man? You're wired up, man. You've been winning people to the Lord. You've been witnessing to people. You've been doing this, you know. Well, you're wired. So what do Christian people do? We don't drink. We don't smoke. We don't chew. We don't go with girls who do. What do we do? Talk to me. What do? We eat. And so we went across there to Big Boy. And I got a revelation. Because in those days, now all those people are gone, but in those days I had folks criticizing my used BMW. But I had a revelation there on Jefferson Avenue at Big Boy. Because who is in a Big Boy on a Saturday morning at 12:30 in the morning? I mean, who's in a Big Boy on Jefferson Avenue? Well, it was the drug dealers and their ladies. And I never saw a parking lot so full of Mercedes and BMWs in my life. And I never saw so much bling in one room in my life. And you know, you never see the media doing an expose on something's wrong here. Who are these drug dealers to be driving these expensive cars and wearing this bling? But they'll come after a preacher. And if they can't find something, they'll just make it up. Our culture is trying to convince us that the curse is good. In the Word of God, wealth goes hand in hand with honor. So what does it mean to honor the Lord with your wealth? There's really only one way to show honor, and that is with money. Why money? Because money is what people treasure most. Talk is cheap, easy, and free, but money costs you something. You traded a part of your life for that money. Money costs something. If honoring doesn't cost you anything, then you didn't honor them. Think about the men that you have worked with that got involved in adultery. They will be cheap, cheap, cheap with their wives, but man, they get some honey on the side and they go to spend it. That's why you ladies have a solemn duty before God to get your husband to spend money on you. Because Jesus said, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Tell your neighbor, there ain't no romance without finance. Honor is the missing ingredient in the body of Christ today with regard to abundant success and wealth. Honor is the missing element in the body of Christ, and this lack of honor is what causes lack among God's people. This is why they're broke. It's a lack of honor. I've always treated my elders and my betters with respect. I've always honored my fathers in the faith, but it never had any material payoff. It never had any impact financially, and I never became a millionaire off of it until after Sue and I gave directly into a man who was blessed. So I mentioned at the beginning, we heard Dr. Price, June of 88, watched him on television, 55 messages, the power of a positive confession, we righted the ship. Actually got a raise in 1982, that was unusual. But it was needs met, that was it. We're sitting in a restaurant, February of 1993, and a bunch of preachers walked in, and Sue looked at me and I looked at her. We'd never been taught this, we'd never heard this, we'd never seen this, we'd never witnessed this. And I said, go ahead. I knew what was in her heart to do. She had she had another zero in her heart than I had in my heart, but I let it go. So she wrote out a check. In fact, I've got the photocopy right. I carry these with me. There's just in this stack, there's $85,000 of canceled checks. And the first one was February 25, 1993, $2,500 to Kenneth and Aretha Hagen. And my wife wrote on their days of heaven upon the earth. Well, as the year progressed, the Lord kept dealing with me. We came to FICWFM in 93, And apparently, because of the date, it was after FICWFM. This is August 4, 1993. I wrote a check to Dr. Fred and Betty Price for $1,000. And then in the summer of 1993, I had a Harley Davidson, my first Harley Davidson. I scrimped and saved, because you know, no self-respect and word of faith, full gospel preacher can have debt on a Harley Davidson. I scrimped and saved, and I owned it. And the Lord told me to give it. And so I liquidated that bike and gave it in a special offering in the church. The first Sunday of October, 1993, and within 45 days, Sue and I were millionaires, and it had nothing to do with the ministry. Now, that's why I said, you don't need to understand everything. You have the Holy Spirit. If you will follow him, he will not lead you into the ditch. He will lead you into the green pastures, and he will lead you beside the still waters. But you understand, since this happened to me, I have been on a quest to find out from the Word of God how this thing works, because guess what? I want to keep working it. Then the next check is July 21, 1994, and that's the one that got the lovely First Lady's attention, because I came in and folks were, you know, a lot of ministry things and ministry gifts, but I gave $5,000 personally to Dr. Price, and I thanked him. I thanked him for my house. Thank you, brother. I thanked him. I thanked him for my cars. Thanked him for my clothes. I thanked him. When you get blessed, that doesn't mean you're the last Coca-Cola in the desert. When you get blessed, that makes you a debtor, because you owe the one who showed you the way. So what changed? We began blessing those who already had the blessing operative in their lives. And let me give you that reference, because that is the heart of everything, and that is Genesis 12, verse 3. Whoever blesses you, I will bless. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. So we bless the man who already had the blessing operative in his life. And this is exactly how Dr. Fred Price got where he got. Just this morning, he mentioned he spent 17 years wandering around four denominations looking for the answer. And I don't think I'm out of line by saying this is not luck or chance. He's special, but during those 17 years in those four denominations, he probably didn't look so special. He made himself special by laying a hold of the Word of God and then working it repeatedly. And it is, I believe, in their hearts and in the heart of God that all of us come into the fat place, that all of us figure it out and begin taking action. How many of you have ever dieted for a day? Now, I want you to be honest. Let me see your hand. You've ever dieted for a day. Let me see your hand. I got my hand up. Dieted for... How many of you have ever exercised for a week or two and quit? Does that work?
No.
Say this out loud. Inconsistency
lies the power.
So we began blessing those who already had the blessing operative in their lives. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. Ecclesiastes 6:2, God gives a man wealth, possessions, and honor, so he lacks nothing his heart desires. So who gives men wealth and honor? God. Who is the source of wealth and honor? It's God. So if it's your desire to lack nothing in your walk with God, you've got to develop a spirit of honor and a determination to show honor in your life. And I do that. I just make it a habit. When I'm around the blessing, I give into the blessing. So what is the money secret of the New Testament? It's found in 1 Timothy 5:17. 1 Timothy 5:17, the elders who direct the affairs of the church well are worthy of double honor, especially those whose work is preaching and teaching. And the word honor here is the Greek word timēs. a noun, genitive, singular, feminine of timei, which the New International Version translates honor. The word timei means honor, precious, price, wages, sum, honorable use, marks of respect, precious value, proceeds, or value. Honor which belongs or is shown to one by reason of the rank and the state of office which he holds, deference, reverence. Gerhard Kittel says of the use of the Greek word timei in 1 Timothy 5:17, the interpretation is disputed. The saying may mean that presbyters should be more honored than simple members of the congregation by virtue of their outstanding service. More likely, however, is the explanation that they are to receive double payment. Bauer Art and Gingrich says the Greek word timei means price, value, honor, or reverence. Under the meanings of price or value, the meaning is often that of price paid for something. Under the meanings of honor or reverence, the meaning is often that of the showing of honor, the showing of reverence, the showing of respect as an action. But get this, Bauer Art and Gingrich gives a third basic meaning for the Greek word timei, and that is honorarium or compensation. The elders who direct the affairs of the church well are worthy of double honor, especially those whose work is preaching and teaching. So can there be any misunderstanding about what Paul is saying? Kittle says that the Greek word timei means worth, honorarium, satisfaction, compensation, elevation, honor, regard, respect, to make a present, to reward, value, or price. The word can also be used to mean to show respect. The concept comes from ancient Greece, where one shows respect and honor to those especially blessed or favored by the gods. In this regard, one gains the favor of the gods by showing respect to those the gods favor. How could the ancient Greeks understand a principle all those thousands of years ago that the modern church still cannot get a grip on? Kittle says timei has, in the first instance, a strong material orientation. For example, in ancient Greek literature, Achilles' honor is functionally dependent on the number of gifts brought to him to persuade him to take part in the battle. So honor is due God, but then honor comes from God to certain men. And it's not because God favored them. It's because they elicited the favor of God. Earthly goods are almost always connected with honor. Timei also means showing honor to others. In this regard, the word also means payment. You pay honor. You show honor. The verb timeo usually means to honor or to show honor, but it also means to reward or to make presentations. So what was Paul meaning to say in 1 Timothy 5:17? The elders who direct the affairs of the church well are worthy of double honor, especially those whose work is teaching and preaching. Let me ask it this way. Of what value, of what price, how much money is your spiritual leadership worth to you? What value do you place on your spiritual leadership? And the answers to these questions will determine the amount of honor you show to your spiritual leadership. And what I've discovered is, in my life, in our walk in this life of success and abundance and prosperity, it's not even really the amount, it's the consistency. Because we live in a microwave generation, man. We want to do what we want to do, and then God answer us by Tuesday, and then we never want to be bothered with it again. But success just doesn't seem to come that way. If you treat God like he's nothing to you, he will be of no value to you. If you treat your wife like she's nothing to you, she will be of no value to you. In the same way, if you treat your spiritual leader like he or she means nothing to you, they will be of no value to you. So they are worthy of what? Double honor, double price, double money, double wages, double value. And then along with that, another concept, and that is of showing honor where honor is due. Romans 13, 7 and 8. Give everyone what you owe him. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. If revenue, then revenue. If respect, then respect. If honor, that's the word team A, then honor. Let no debt remain outstanding. 1 Corinthians 9:11, if we have sown spiritual seed among you, is it too much if we reap a material harvest from you? So if you're blessed, you owe the tithe to your great God with whom you claim to be walking in covenant. But if you are blessed, you also showed the man of God or the woman of God who showed you the way. Amen. Amen. So I stand here tonight, and it's no problem for me because it doesn't diminish me. Abraham's not diminished by Melchizedek. Now, I'm not saying Pastor Price is Melchizedek. I'm not saying he stands in the office of Melchizedek, because that is the office of the Lord Jesus Christ. What I'm saying is there is an anointing. There is a particular anointing, and it flows not from the lineage of Aaron and Levi. It flows from the lineage of Melchizedek. I believe with all of my heart that if it were not for my fathers in the faith, I would not live where I live. I would not drive what I drive. I would not have an 83-acre campus valued at $16.5 million. And for me personally to believe anything different would be pompous and arrogant. My fathers in the faith showed me the way. And you know what that makes me? A debtor. I owe my fathers in the faith. Why? Because they showed me the way. They figured it out ahead of me. And then they were gracious enough to let me in on it. Now, a critic would say, well, it's all about money. And I would say, no, it's not all about money, but money is a part of it. When the Word begins to work in our lives, when the Word that we have been taught begins to pay off in our lives, that makes us debtors. So we need to show honor where honor's due. We should acknowledge those who showed us the way. And not just with lip service, we need to really show honor, a showing of honor that cost us something. Of course, the first point of showing honor is the tithe. But are you telling me that a man making $100,000 a year should just tithe? Are you telling me that a man making $250,000 a year should just tithe? Are you telling me that a man making $500,000 or $1 million a year should just tithe? Proverbs 3, 9, and 10 says, honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. Then your barns will be filled overflowing, and your vats will brim over with new wine. So it's this lack of honor that is causing lack among God's people. Number three and my last point, the anointing secret of the Bible, and it ties it all together. Let's go back to Abraham and Melchizedek and look at the transference of the blessing. Genesis 12, 3, I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. You see, God loves his anointed, favored, and blessed chosen men. So it's stupid, it's foolish, it's self-destructive to be critical or cynical of them. Besides, if you can't believe that God loves his anointed, favored, and blessed, and chosen leadership, how will you ever be able to believe that God could love you? The people in our church think that I spend 52 Sundays a year trying to convince them to believe in God, and I don't. Believing in God is a piece of cake. I spend 52 Sunday mornings a year trying to get the people to believe in themselves. Because if you can believe in yourself, then you can do anything. Because God loves you, God's with you, God's for you. But there's got to be something on the inside of you that says, I can do it. I can do it. I can do what that guy did. I can do what that gal did. I can drive what that guy's driving. I don't covet what that guy's driving. I want a different color, but I can have it. If you can't believe that God loves Dr. Fred Price or Kenneth Copeland, how will you ever be able to believe that God could love you? Look at Genesis 12, 3 in the Amplified, or let me read it to you. Genesis 12, 3, Amplified. And I will bless those who bless you, who confer prosperity or happiness upon you, and curse him who curses or uses insolent language toward you. In you shall all the families and kindred of the earth be blessed. By you they shall bless themselves. By Genesis 12, 3 Amplified, by you they shall bless themselves. Now, I'm fully aware as I wrap this up that there may be some controversy in what I'm about to say. But whether you agree or disagree, I'm simply stating the way I have seen things unfold in my own life. Sue and I have had many great fathers in the faith, beginning with Finest Jennings Dake, Dr. Lester Summerall, Kenneth Hagin, T.L. Osborne, David Yonggi Cho, Oral Roberts, Dr. Fred Price, John Osteen. But out of those fathers in the faith, there were two in particular who had a primary impact on us in this area of faith, and they were Kenneth Hagin and Fred Price. And those were the same two who carried on them an anointing for prosperity. I love them all. I wouldn't say anything to diminish anybody. But there sits a child of the Depression. But the Depression never had a hold on them. I mean, I love these great fathers in the faith, but you could see it. In other words, they were wonderful. I learned a lot from them, but they were children of the Depression, and that Depression was always around the corner somewhere in their thinking. But those two men, they were blessed. They carried on them an anointing for success. There's no doubt in anybody's mind. We could take Dr. Frederick K.C. Price. We could put him in any city in America at age 77. He could start tomorrow with nothing, and he would be incredibly successful and incredibly prosperous. There's no doubt in anybody's mind. Well, guess what? He ain't going. But why can't I take some of him with me when I go? Why can't I get some of what's on him to come on me so that when I go to my town, I got that same anointing on me? I'm talking about anointing. I'm talking about adding the anointing to the promises which we all know we have. They walked in favor, and they obviously had the blessing of God in their lives. So I associated myself with these men, and every time I saw them, I gave into their lives. I gave money into their lives. I gave serious money into their lives. I associated myself with them. I didn't associate myself with them just verbally. I gave into their lives. Both of those men flew in private jets, but I didn't allow that to offend me. On the contrary, I was encouraged by that. Both of those men wore tailor-made suits. I didn't allow that to offend me. On the contrary, I was encouraged by that. I said to myself that I too would someday wear tailor-made suits. And so it is today that every suit, every sport coat, every tux I own was tailor-made for me in Italy. Say it out loud. What one man can do, another man can do. And I tell people, if you don't like it, blame Dr. Price. Both of those men wore tailor-made shoes. You know, tailor-made suits are one thing, but tailor-made shoes are just over the top. But I didn't allow that to offend me. On the contrary, I was encouraged by that. I said to myself that I too would someday wear tailor-made shoes. And so it is today that every pair of alligator shoes I own were tailor-made for me in Italy. And every pair of, because I'm from Texas, every pair of alligator boots I own were made for me in El Paso by the same company that made boots for Gary Cooper and John Wayne. For years, Dr. Fred Price drove Bentleys. I didn't allow that to offend me. Stop listening to the stupid media. I didn't allow that to offend me. I was encouraged by that. I said to myself that I too would someday drive Bentleys. And so today, every car I own, all three are Bentleys that I purchased new. People who allow themselves to get discouraged when they stand in the presence of God's favor, when they stand in the presence of God's anointing, when they stand in the presence of God's anointed, when they stand in the presence of the blessing in somebody else's life, they don't get it. You see, if I had connected with all of those fathers in the faith, minus those two men, I would not be building the home I'm building. I would not be driving what I'm driving. I would not be wearing what I'm wearing. Not only that, my son Austin and his wife Jessica would not be living in the home they are living in. Not only that, our church would not own 83 acres. We would not be meeting in that beautiful new facility. No, if I had connected to all of those wonderful fathers in the faith, minus these two that carried the blessing in their lives, I'd still be at that starter church on Interstate 30. The media will never admit it. Your relatives, neighbors, and co-workers will never admit it. But literally every time any of our members drive onto our 83 acres, they are deriving benefit from the giving that Sue and I did into the lives of those who already had the blessing on their lives. Every time any of our members set foot in our facility, they are deriving benefit from the giving that Sue and I did into the lives of those who already had the blessing on their lives. Every time a child sets foot on one of our our two playgrounds, they are deriving benefit from the giving that Sue and I did into the lives of those who already had the blessing on their lives. Every time a student at our private Christian academy plays on one of those two baseball diamonds, or the soccer field, or the football field, they are deriving benefit from the giving that Sue and I did into the lives of those who already had the blessing on their lives. That is the power of what I'm talking about this evening. So the blessing comes by association with the anointed of the Lord. So when you find someone who is blessed, bless them. Did you hear what I said? When you find someone who is blessed, bless them. I think about 20% are getting it. When you find someone who is blessed, Dr. Lester Summerall was a crusty, wonderful man. And I won't call the name, but he told me about one of these ministers that has the food lines in Africa. And he told me, because that was on his 13 stations, he told me, he said, that man flies into an area on his private jet, it's all set up, they get out of the plane, they ladle soup to some kids, they take photos, they roll TV tape, they fold it all up, they get back on the jet. He said 30 minutes on the ground and it's worth 3 months of fundraising. The bottom line is, a lot of what we've been given to, we don't know what the heck's going on. But when you walk into a church, not just this church, when you walk into a church, you got a man there who works there, you got a life there. You wonder what's going on? Check out the wife, check out the children. You can see with your eyeballs if you are giving into good soil when you give into a church. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. So this is the anointing secret of the Bible. For example, the widow of Zarephath in 1 Kings 17 got blessed by being a blessing to the anointed man of God, Elijah, who was already blessed before she ever met him. So when you find someone who is blessed, bless them, and then believe that the blessing that is on them will come on you. Same thing with the calling of Elisha in 1 Kings 19. Back in those days at the Maybe Center, there were these two guys especially. They were always talking about the double portion, you know, the double portion. They were going to get the double portion and couldn't wait for these old guys to die. They were going to take over. Man, they're gone. They're not even in the ministry. They're washed up. You don't get this by confessing it. You get this by being a blessing. Elisha served Elijah. Elisha was there for Elijah. Elisha gave into the life of Elijah. There was no luck or chance to it. So when you find someone who is blessed, bless them. We see the same thing with the Shunammite woman in 2 Kings 4. She got blessed by being a blessing to the anointed man of God, Elisha, who was already blessed before she ever met him. See, Melchizedek was blessed before Abraham met him. When we give to those who have the blessing, we're not blessing them. I mean, we are, but we're blessing ourselves. Genesis 12:3 Amplified. By blessing them, we're blessing ourselves. That's intelligent. So when you find someone who's blessed, bless them. And then believe God that the blessing that's on them is coming on you. It's what I call giving into the anointing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. So this is what happens when I connect with someone who has the blessing on them. The blessing that is on them comes upon me. So I began doing this in 1993, as led by the Holy Spirit. All through the 90s, I began doing this. I would come across these great men of God. I'd give into their lives. I didn't expect it. I didn't plan on it. No one taught me about it. But what happened over time, I began to see that I had an anointing on me. To the best of my knowledge, I've never had a millionaire walk into my church. But I got a bunch of millionaires. We created them. We taught them the word. We emboldened them. We emboldened them to believe in themselves and open up businesses. Every preacher in town's running around trying to get the other preacher's millionaire. You get this anointing on you, you go back home, you'll begin to create millionaires. So when you find someone who's blessed, bless them and believe that the blessing that is on them will come on you. And I will bless those who bless you, who confer prosperity or happiness upon you, and curse him who curses or uses insolent language toward you. In you shall all the families and kindred of the earth be blessed. By you they shall bless themselves. You see, the priesthood of Jesus today is the priesthood of Melchizedek. And nothing's going to happen until we get our minds off sinning and we get our minds on winning. Your financial destiny is in your hands. Religion will tell you that God will not help you in your career. Religion will tell you that God is against your prosperity, and at the same time, he is for or permits the prosperity and the wealth of the wicked. But consider the great men of the Bible. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob all became wealthy. All of Samuel's needs were met. He actually appointed kings and gave them commands to follow. Even in captivity, God made Joseph and Daniel wealthy. Jesus himself never had a financial need, even though he had a staff of 12 and a thief for a treasurer. The Apostle Paul traveled the world, yet said that he was amply supplied. So dare to be like the great men and women of the Bible. Dare to follow God's plan for your life right down to your wallet. God will help you to become a success in this life. I want to thank you for the word that came out of your mouth. I want to thank you for loving your wife. I want to thank you for loving your children. You taught me how to make rules for myself and follow those rules. You taught me to go on vacation. You taught me how to pay my home off. I did that twice. And you got your testimony right here. You got a wife that's still crazy about you. You got children that love you. So I bless you, man of God. And when I'm all grown up, I want to be just like you.
Thank you, buddy. Love you.